lies that the world believes is where we started last week. Three lies that the world believes. And unfortunately, we found out that there's more than just the world that believes this. Some of the church believes this. The first lie is that we're all God's children. We are all God's children. These are things that were used in Sunday school systems throughout the United States. Again, we're not slamming churches. We're not bashing churches. We're just talking the truth here and saying that sometimes error can creep in. We're all God's children. We're all God's children. All literature used in churches. When the truth is, we are all God's creation.
Yes, sir.
We're all God's creation, but we are not all God's children, all right? And we looked at a couple of verses, John 1, 12, and 1 John 3. We spent our entire sermon on those two particular verses. And, but you know, the best laid plans of pastors and friends, I thought we'd get through more than that, but we got stopped there on the way. And so we're going to pick up with where we are now. So go to Romans 9, 8 with me. Romans 9, 8. I would remind you, you know, I love the electronic Bibles, but please, when you're studying at home, use paper Bibles. Use paper, because there may be a day when there is no electricity, and boy, you're going to be sunk without one. You know, if we ever have a day where, you know, we used to have to smuggle Bibles into the Iron Curtain, heavens to Betsy, if the tribulation and hardship ever falls, then we may wish that we had more than just electronic Bibles. Amen?
Amen.
I love them. I've recommended them. I've recommended an app to our church. The Literal Word is a New American Standard. That has word studies built into it, and it's absolutely free. So it's a good one. But Romans 9:8 says, that is, it is not the children of the flesh who are the children of God. Okay, we're done. Let's go home. That's the truth, right? I mean, the lie is we're all God's children. It says, it is not the children of the flesh who are the children of God, but the children of the promise are regarded as descendants. Those who keep the promise that was given that there would be a Messiah, there would be a Redeemer, there would be a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. Those who adhere to Him and follow Him are the children of God. Look at Romans 8. Go back one chapter. Romans 8:14. Romans 8:14 says, for all who are being led by the Spirit of God, these are the
sons of God.
Not everybody's child of God, because not everybody is following what the Spirit of the Lord says, in the church and outside the church. For you have not received a spirit of slavery leading to fear again, but you've received a spirit of adoption as sons of which we cry out, Abba, Father. The Spirit Himself testifies with our spirit that we are children of God, and if children, heirs also, heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ, if indeed we suffer with Him, so that we may also be glorified with Him. Never got promised a bed of roses in Christianity. Never got promised that everything was just going to be sweet honey and daffodils, right? If the Lord suffered, we will suffer. Now, the beauty of it is He took His suffering upon us, and we no longer have to pay the price for that suffering. Here it tells us very, very clearly that because of the suffering, we will not be downtrodden, but we will be glorified with Him. Amen? And I don't know about you, but that's good. That's good news, and that's what we have to hold on to. But it does require the following of Christ to be a child of God. Galatians 3. Galatians 3. That's after the Corinthians, okay? So keep going back a little bit. Galatians 3, verse 26. And by the way, last week is on YouTube. It's on Facebook. If you want to go back and get the first part, it is certainly there, okay? Galatians 3:26 says, for you are all sons of God, but there's another half in there, through faith in Christ Jesus. Those who have faith in Christ, those who have followed. Remember, it is not a prayer that saves you. It's not a prayer that saves you. The prayer is the pronouncement of the fact that I am giving up my life and taking up your life. It's taking up the cross of Christ. It is the death, burial, and resurrection that baptism symbolizes. That's what saves. The prayer is to enter into that covenant, but it is a covenant life that is being born again. You are not born again because you mutter a few words. Talk's cheap. And a lot of people say a lot of things and not follow through. Anybody know of anybody like that? You ever had somebody do that to you before? I think God's had more than us put together. who have told them that they were going to do something and never followed through. Many people pray a prayer at church camp and think that that's it and that's all there is to it. But the Bible says you're to repent and be baptized.
Yes.
Now, if you're too young to repent about something, then you haven't repented. My prayer as a child was sincere, and I'm telling you, I was born again as a child. But I didn't understand my salvation until I was an older teen, and I knew what sin was, and I was one, and I was sorry for it.
Yeah. There you go.
Then I understood repentance.
Amen.
Then I could seek forgiveness. And so that is being a child of God. That's lie number one. What's lie number two? Lie number two is everyone goes to heaven. Now, the world believes that everybody's going to go to heaven or somewheres. They're not all sure what it is. There's a book out called Everyone Goes to Heaven, including your pets and animals. And the whole idea is that dinosaurs will be in heaven. And I believe animals will be in heaven. The Bible says animals are going to be in heaven. But remember, animals don't have spirits. They don't have to be redeemed. Animals have souls. And so they are in heaven because of the grace of God. I'm in heaven because of the grace of God, but it's because my spirit chose to become a child of God.
Amen.
Big difference, okay? Big difference. This meme, everybody goes to heaven. Actually, everyone goes to heaven no matter what you do or believe. Let's face it, how many funerals do people go to and say, well, remember, you'll see your loved one in a better place? The fact that they were a drug dealer, murderer, child molester means nothing on the other side. We'll all meet together in heaven. Phooey is what the Greek says. Phooey, are you kidding me?
Yes, come on.
Oh, no, we're all going to meet in heaven. Oh, we're all going to be up there. It's all going to be a better place. I can't tell you how many funerals I've sat through and just thought, oh, my goodness, oh, my soul. You are lying to these people and probably lying to yourself. That's just not true. And everybody believes they're all going to get wings and angels and heavens and good Lord. Even Victoria's Secret had an angel's runway. That an entire show on television of scantily clad women wearing lingerie with wings on their back talking about fallen angels. Now, ain't that something to brag about? Isn't that something to be proud of? I can't tell you how many young ladies come to school wearing t-shirts that have angels' wings painted on the back. It's a trendy thing. You can find them online, and they're angels. Living like the devil, but they're angels. You know, we all think that this is going to be the end resting place because we deserve it, because we've been good, because we ain't been Hitler. Hitler won't be there. Well, maybe he will because he was a good boy and loved his mama. Are you kidding me? Get real. The truth is, more people are going to go to hell than go to heaven. More people will go to hell than go to heaven. Now, that's an ugly thought.
Come on.
Don't you wish the Bible was more gentle? Don't you wish the Bible was more like how I think things should be? Look at Matthew 7 with me. Matthew 7, 13 and 14. Now, again, I'm preaching this sermon not so much because I think people in my church believe these lies, but I'll bet you've got family members and coworkers that do, and you need some Bible verses you can present.
Yes.
And I'm giving you tools to put in your toolbox. That's all I'm doing.
Amen.
Last week I said I'm putting ammunition in your gun, and that sounded really violent. So I'll say, let's put tools in your toolbox. Okay? I don't mind packing and carrying myself. I'm not going to ask you to, but let's be honest, it's tools. These are tools in your toolbox. And 7:13 says, enter through the narrow gate, for the gate is wide and the way broad that leads to destruction. And there are many who are going to enter through it. For the gate is small and the way is narrow that leads to life, and there are few who find it. That's what I just said. And some of you little hackles went up on your back and said, really? I'm not sure I'll believe that, Pastor. That sounds kind of mean. But that's what Scripture says. What Scripture says. And our validation of truth is what God says, not what we feel. Okay, go down a couple verses to 21. 21 through 23. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father who is in heaven will enter. Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name, and in your name cast out demons, and in your name perform many miracles? And then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. Yeah. There is a difference between you knowing something about God and the Lord having a relationship with you. Yeah. There's a big difference.
Yes.
There was, when I was growing up, when I was a young adult, a revolution in the evangelical church about discipleship. Up until then, the church had been very evangelistic, and we were growing leaps and bounds through evangelism. Baptisms were rampant. Churches were on every corner. Billy Graham was actually a hero in the press and elsewhere. In other words, being religious wasn't nasty. It wasn't ugly. It was preferred. And it was nothing to go to work and talk about where you went to church. Where do you go to church? Well, I go here. Well, where do you go? I go there. And you could talk about it. A very few people looked at you and said, we don't go. That was kind of, you were on the outs if you didn't go. It was kind of a popular thing to do. But then they raised a question of the difference between evangelism and discipleship. Because many people were being born again and going out the back door. Coming in the front door and saying, I'm born again. Then you never see them again. And so there was a question as to whether or not we were discipling or training people in the way of God. We're getting them saved, but are they really following through? And whose fault is that? It's the church's fault to teach a believer how to walk. And so we started all kinds of lay ministries and lay revivals and discipleship courses and different groups like the Navigators and Campus Crusade for Christ, many, many good organizations. But all of them, what we call parachurch or outside the church, started doing the job of the church because the church wasn't doing its job and wasn't discipling people as they did. And so there became this distinction that many people had gotten Jesus as Savior, but not everyone had gotten him as Lord. You remember that discussion, those of you who have been around church a while? You know, we're teaching Jesus Savior, but it's another step to make him Lord. And to make him Lord of your life is not salvation, but it's following him, it's discipling, it's choosing him. And we made this imaginary line between the two. I'm here to tell you that unless Jesus is Lord, you ain't saved. You can't split Savior and Lord. You can't divide the two. The farmer who plants is the same one who harvests is the same one that plows. You can't say, I'll take farmer the plower, but not the harvester, or vice versa. It's one in one.
Yes.
And there are going to be a lot of people who even have been discipled and say, Lord, Lord. And the Lord's going to say, you may have known something about me, but I didn't know anything about you. Mm-hmm. Who are you? Lord, don't you remember, though, but I was in church and I cast out demons. I performed miracles. There were people who were healed under my prayer touch. And he's going to say, yeah, my power is there, but the relationship never was. We know that there are instances in the New Testament, like the sons of Sceva, of those who went around and cast out demons in the name of this unknown Jesus that they'd never met. And the demons left. But then the demons came back and beat the snot out of them.
Yeah, they sure did.
Just jumped all over those seven sons and just made a mess of them. You see, they didn't have the relationship. And it's the relationship, that laying down of my life, that dying to self and rising again in the newness of Christ, yes, that is salvation. Those are the ones who are going to go to heaven. Look at Revelation 21:8. But for the cowardly and
unbelieving.
Say it again.
Unbelieving.
For the cowardly and unbelieving and abominable and murderers. The unbelieving are right up there with Hitler. Okay? With the abominable murderers, the immoral persons, the sorcerers, idolaters, and all liars, their part will be in the lake that burns with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. You see, that just doesn't sound like everybody goes to heaven, does it? Go back one chapter. Go to Revelation 20, verse 15. So many people believe that because they are born in America that they are Christian, and because they're Christian, they're saved, and because they're saved, they're going to go to heaven. You know, there's that old adage that being born in a bakery don't make you a donut. It doesn't make you one, does it?
No,
sir. So Revelation 20:15 says, "And if anyone's name was not found written in the book of life, he was thrown into the lake of fire." That narrow gate and that broad gate. That narrow gate and that broad gate. Now I've shown you enough pictures of Jerusalem that you know that there are narrow gates that you enter in where pedestrians walk in, and there are the broad gates where the horses and the carts come in and where the wagons come in. And there are two different gates in every old city gate. In fact, some of the city gates have a door in front of the pedestrian one. There's a wooden door that's closed at night. The big wooden doors are closed in the big gate, and they're double barred so that no one can storm that. And the gates in the old city of Jerusalem are built like an L. They're L-shaped so that you come in from the side and then you turn 90 degrees and come into the city. Now, that's so it builds a bottleneck so that if an army comes running in there, they got to turn and you can know where to point your arrows and stack them up like wood. Thud, 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 thud. And then pretty soon the gate's cluttered. You can't even get in. But at night, there's actually a wooden door that they close and they lock. And you show up in the middle of the night and you're a traveling salesman. And you want to come into the city for safety and you want to sleep and you want to get yourself a hotel and a good meal. But the gates are already closed. So you come up to the pedestrian gate and you knock on the pedestrian gate and the guard comes and clears you. And they open a door within the door. So just imagine that this is a door, although the doors in the old city are about half this high. They're very short so that you can't ride a horse in, and you have to bend down to get in, because if you have a sword in your hand and you're an enemy army, I want you to slow down and put your head in first. And my sword is waiting for you. Lop. Next. I mean, have you ever taken those rolls of cookies and kind of chopped them up, made cookies out of them so you could bake them? There we go. Okay, just slop, slop, slop. So there is these little tiny doors that you got to bend down to go into. But inside of that door is another door. There's a smaller door. There's a door that's only about this high. And they will open that and admit you, and that's called the eye of the needle. For a rich man to enter heaven, it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of the needle, you see. It has nothing to do with stitching and sewing. It's the gate that enters into the city. And it's the wooden gate that protects everyone. But everybody knows the eye of the needle is really too small for a camel. Can we get a camel through there? If it can wiggle on its knees, we can. But the chances of the camel going through there and the chances of a rich person getting through there are about the same. Again, God is not against wealth. He's against the love of money. That's the root of all evil. Money is not evil. We wouldn't have missionaries if we didn't have money. We wouldn't have church if we didn't have money. We wouldn't have pastors, thank you, Lord, if we didn't have money. Amen? You got to have the money to make the world go around. But it is the love of money which is the root of all evil. And for the rich man who loves it more than he loves the Lord, he's just about as easy for him to get in as a camel going through that door within a door. The eye of the needle. There are only three eyes of the needle still left in Jerusalem. There are only three that are still left. And we take you by one of those up on the Temple Mount. It is right on the Temple Mount, and it's one of the Arab gates that lets you in. It's called the Gate of the Bakers. And it's where the Arab bakers used to set up on that street. And you'd have to walk through all the bakeries and then enter into the temple area. But we still have an eye of the needle there. And we try and stop and let you have a picture taken if you want to with the eye of the needle, because it's significant. There aren't a lot of them around anymore, but it's there. So this whole concept of our getting in, suddenly not everybody is going to go to heaven. Lie number three. There are many ways to God. Now again, I'm sure the people in this church do not believe this one iota, but how many of you know family members who do? Yes. Ah, I would say the majority of America believes this, although it really is a more of a Hindu custom and concept. But Hinduism crept into the United States during the 1960s through the Beatles and others who went to the whole Maharishi Mahesh Yogi route and did transcendental meditation and took drugs. And suddenly we went from Rubber Soul album with Michelle, my bell, to the Magical Mystery Tour. What was that all about? Hinduism turned them on to better drugs. That's what it was all about. They went to India and found the good stuff and came back stoned. Many ways to God. I remember being in a senior in high school and remembering that the Maharishi Mahesh Yogi, which was the guru for the rock stars, came to the United States and filled every major auditorium in the United States for multiple nights for a week at a time, filling the Houston Astrodome, which was at that time the largest stadium in the United States. That man filled it for six nights, standing room only, at $100 a ticket, which today would be about $1,100. He got to go home and buy even better drugs. Ka-ching, ka-ching. People were hungry. People were searching and looking. Thank goodness the Lord answered that call, and the Jesus movement came out of that.
Yeah.
Amen? Many ways to God. Oh, my goodness. All paths to God. 10 paths to God. This is a Jewish writing. This is a Christian writing. This is a Catholic writing. The two paths to God. Those are coming from religions of today. Of course, we know that Hinduism points that way. The mystical paths to God, the paths to God, living the Bhagavad Gita, coexist. God is one of the paths to reach Him. There are many, religions are many, just as different rivers originating in different mountains traverse different paths, flowing straight or crooked, and at last join the ocean. He is the one Lord of all, the one soul of all souls. Many, many ways to get there. That's the Swami Vivekananda. And then one of our American rabbis, Oprah. I believe there are many paths to God. I certainly don't believe that there's only one way. There couldn't possibly just be one way to God. I'm a Christian who believes that there are certainly many more paths to God other than Christianity. That tells me something very important. She ain't no Christian. I am the way, the truth, and the life. But if Oprah says so, that ain't true. It's not what Jesus said. One of the biggest mistakes humans make is to believe that there is only one way. There are many diverse paths leading to what you call God. Pluralism, it's called. Islam and pluralism. Pluralism and Hinduism, atheism, discrimination, Buddhism, Judaism, humanism, perspective. Syncretism is another way. Syncretism is the blending of religions. It's the taking of what's good here and what's good there. In many, many South American and Central American cities that you go to, the Catholic priests will participate in the local religions of the natural gods. And the female god who rules the country becomes Mary. And the male god becomes Jesus. And we celebrate the skeleton demonic Day of the Dead in Mexico, which is a blending of Satan worship and Christianity. The blending of these religions so that in a church altar, you not only have Jesus, but you have just about everyone who ever met him that you can worship. And then the assumption and coronation of the Virgin, the Queen of Heaven, that there are two ways, two paths. You can be saved through a relationship with Jesus and the church, or you can be saved through a relationship with Mary and the church. The truth is, Jesus is the only way to be saved. Jesus is the only way to be saved. John 14:6. I just quoted this. Maybe you didn't know where it was, but now you do. John 14:6, Jesus said to him, I am. Now that's insignificant. I am. I am, he said. The great I am of the Old Testament, the great I am of the Exodus, the great I am of Mount Sinai.
Yes.
The great I am. Who should I say sent me? Moses asked, and God said, tell them that I am sent you.
Yes.
I am the past, I am the present, I am the future, I am all that you will ever need. I am the great I am. I created and will end this thing because it's all mine. I am. And Jesus said, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. Only one path. It may be inconvenient for our world to accept, but it is what the Word says. Look at John 3. Go back one. John 3:16. Some of you ought to know that verse, right? Probably the most quoted verse in all of Christendom. Although in some of the circles today, the most quoted verse is, no weapon formed against me shall prosper. Which is unfortunate, because the most important verse ought to be how to be saved, not how to get ahead.
Right.
How to get ahead has become as important in the church as how to be born again. And some churches would much rather have you get ahead than be saved. John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. God so loved the world that he said, there's one way to get to me, and here he is. Not in multiple ways. There's one way, and this is it. I'm here, you're there, here's the bridge, take it.
Amen.
John 3:36 says, he who believes in the Son has... Say it again.
Eternal.
One more time.
Eternal.
He who believes in the Son has eternal life, but he who does not obey the Son, obey the Son. Obey. See, that's why prayer doesn't save you. Prayer doesn't save you. The obeying the Son will not see life, but the wrath of God abides on him. The lake of fire. There is only one way to be saved. Look at Acts 4. Verses 10, 11, 12. Acts 4, 10 says, let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ the Nazarene, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, by this name, this man stands here before you in good health. He is the stone which was rejected by you, the builders, but which became the chief cornerstone. And there is salvation in... no one else. No one else. For there is no other name under heaven that has been given among men by which we must be saved.
Amen.
There's only one. There's only one. Look at Acts 13. Again, giving you tools. Giving you tools. If judgment falls on the United States, we need to be ready with tools. If judgment doesn't fall on the United States, we need to be ready with tools. Amen? Acts 13:38 says, therefore, let it be known to you, brethren, that through him forgiveness of sins is proclaimed to you, and through him everyone who believes is freed from all things from which you could not be freed through the law of Moses. Therefore, take heed. Amen? There is one name that is going to get it done, and that's it. 1 Timothy 2:5. 1 Timothy 2:5 says, for there is one God and one mediator also between God and men, the man, Christ Jesus.
Amen.
One mediator. And how did he make peace between man and God? The next verse says, who gave himself as a ransom for all. You see, Jesus paid your bill at Colton's. He paid your bill at Colton's. And he's the only one that has a right to say so. He's the only one that has a right to say so, because he paid it. If you say you're paid your bill, you're a liar. If you say somebody else paid your bill, you're a liar. One person paid your bill. He was the ransom for all. Well, we've kind of run through this, but I think that we've understood that there are three lies that the world believes. And the church shouldn't support that belief system. We need to stand firm, and we need to have the ammunition at hand, the tools in hand, to say, that's a lie. Now, God sends the truth. Who sends the lie?
The devil.
So we can say that's a lie out of the pit of hell. It may sound like love, but it is not love. Amen?
Amen.
Let's bow our heads and let's pray together.